Well, good morning. Good morning. Thank you for coming out on this snowy morning. One of the things I really quickly want to address as I welcome you is this morning in my Faith Builders class, we talked about having a reason for why we do what we do. And I want to bring you up to speed on why Calvary is here. We are here to connect people to God. And we do that in many different ways. And one of the ways that we do that is connecting people to people. And so as people are filing in and then coming this morning, I want to welcome you, but I want to give you the opportunity to stand and connect with a few people around you. So would you please take this opportunity to do that? You'll take them to the next level, and you'll grow in relationship with each other and ultimately connecting each other to God. And that's why we're here. Thank you for being here. And one of the things I want to give you an opportunity for is as we connect with each other and we connect in the community, we have opportunities to serve. And one area that we can kind of help out with is, you know that normally Calvary has concert events that happen here. Well, there's another Christmas concert happening in the Chippewa Valley that is coming up next week, and they need help. They are running a little bit low on volunteers, and so I would encourage you, if you have a heart to serve or you're looking for a place at Christmas that you can get your family involved and help out, this is an event that is obviously going to be a great celebration of who Jesus Christ is at this Christmas season. We can focus on that, but we can also help them out. So if you need more information, if you say, yeah, I can help with some sort of volunteer work there at that concert, please let me know or call the church office. All of that information is right here in your connector. There's lots more announcements to be taken care of, but we're not going to take the time to do that. I would encourage all of you to read through this. There's lots of things in here like the envelopes for our missionary love offering and also for our elder fund offering. Please take the time to flip through that and be up to speed on how to connect here at Calvary and in the community. Would you please all turn your attention towards our Almighty God as we enter into a time of call to worship?
Just one more quick announcement about the concert. Tickets are available for that concert still, and they will be for sale right after the service in the atrium if you don't have your tickets yet, and all of a sudden you've decided you wanted to go to Zorn Arena this weekend for that Christmas concert. Tickets will be available right after the service today. Would you stand, please? In Psalm chapter 65, we read several verses, and then the first two verses of Psalm 66. Listen to what the psalmist says as we enter into this time of celebrating with great joy that the King has arrived, and that's why we celebrate. By awesome deeds, you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation, the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas. You make going out of the morning and the evening to shout for joy. The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of His name. Give to Him glorious praise. Joy to the world.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We are full of joy.
Scripture. And Scripture tells us that as we have that joy and we understand where that joy comes from, Psalm 37:21 says, "The righteous is generous and gives." And so I hope this morning, as that joy overtakes you and you understand who God is and what He's done for you, that generosity would take over as well. And this is a season of giving, but giving is not just limited to this season. And so I would encourage you to seek out who God is and what He's done and be generous and joyful. As the ushers come forward this morning to receive our tithes and offerings, let's pray. Father, we do come before You, Almighty God, and express as much as we can speak it, an unspeakable joy. Father, what You have done by giving us Your Son, Jesus Christ, as a salvation for our sins, from our sins. Oh, Lord, thank You so much, and I pray that as we sing these different songs, that they wouldn't just be out of tradition, and that it wouldn't just be words on a screen, but Lord, they would be the expression of our hearts, that joy wells up inside of us that we just can't contain it. And one of the ways that it fleshes itself out is through generosity. Lord, there is great need in our community. There is great blessing that we have the ability to pour out onto our missionaries. Lord, I pray right now that each one of us would generously not just give what we're supposed to give, but we would go above and beyond and bless our missionaries and bless people through the Elder Fund. Thank You for this incredible opportunity, Lord, but thank You most of all for Your Son. It's in His name that we pray. Amen. As the ushers are receiving the offering, I'd like to introduce Mr. Keith Carey. And he is one of our elders, and he's going to do week 2 of our Advent calendar.
Hello. Ooh, it's on. Week 2 of Advent celebration is on the thought of prepare. Sing to Yahweh, you His faithful ones, and praise His holy name, for His anger lasts only a moment, but His favor a lifetime. Weeping may spend the night, but there is joy in the morning. When I was secure, I said, I will never be shaken. Psalms 30, verses 4 through 6. Whenever we're on mission with God, like Joseph and Mary, whereas they waited for the birth of Jesus, we have to prepare. No one plants a seed one day and expects a harvest in the morning. There are things to do. We're called to cultivate our lives and rest in the fact that God has our future in His hands. Preparation is a statement of faith. It's committing to trust even though you're hurting and heartsick. Every detail of Christmas story tells us that Mary and Joseph endured more than their fair share of trials as they waited for the arrival of Jesus. Mary left town. Joseph refused to reject her on the basis of an angelic dream. And we can just hear the neighbors gossip about the scandalous events of Mary's pregnancy. But they prepared, and they endured it all to be on a much greater mission than any carpenter's family could ever imagine. So as we prepare for Christmas and all that God has in store for us in the new year and days ahead, let's be challenged to prepare for what all that's in store, and we can do it in the following ways. Eliminate distractions. Don't allow the stress of Christmas season to distract you from what is really important. Spend more time with family, less time at the mall. Simplify your life. Be still and listen to God's voice. Hebrews 12:2 says, keeping your eyes on Jesus is the source and perfecter of our faith. Secondly, you can notice God's hand at work in your life. Reflect on this past year. Perhaps you, like many, have faced financial difficulty, or maybe you've escaped danger or disease through some unforeseen miracle. Perhaps this past year, you've been through a time of suffering or relationship disasters. How has God carried you through all of these things? Remember the words of Joseph in the Old Testament, in Genesis 50, verse 20. You planned evil against me, but God planned good. Thirdly, discern God's will for your life. Ask God to give you direction. A man's heart plans his own way, but the Lord determines his steps, we find in Proverbs 16:9. And fourthly, unite in a mission. Mary and Joseph undertook an amazing mission on the way to Bethlehem. It certainly must have strengthened their bond as they conquered many of the obstacles and challenges. There's nothing more powerful than a couple, a family, and a church rallying around a cause. So reflect. Maybe you can, as you prepare, you can discuss ways with your family or your Bible study group on what are some of our plans and what can we be preparing for in the future. Identify distractions that are going to keep you from truly worshiping Christ this Christmas. And pray. Ask God to help you see what he wants you to do as you move forward in life. And you can express that faith by getting involved. Go on a mission as a family or with a group of friends. Find a family or an organization you can help as they prepare to celebrate Christmas. Focus on the Lord as we move forward and as we plan. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you're our sovereign God, that we can rest in you, and we can trust you, and that we know that you have ordained for us steps, Lord, that would be the best for us if we would just seek you and follow you. Help us, Lord, to organize ourselves and to seek you as we go through this Christmas season and as we go into the new coming year. Continue, Lord, to use us for your purpose and your glory. And thank you for loving us and just giving this opportunity. And we just love you and we ask this in your son's name. Amen.
One of the ways that Calvary connects, not just in this community, but we connect with people worldwide. And we do that through different missionaries that we support. At this time, I'd like to call up Cecil Burley, who is on our AIM team, which is our Area and International Missions team. And he would like to introduce to you some new missionaries that we're able to support to continue the efforts of reaching the whole world with the gospel.
Thank you, Josh. Wow, what a blessing to see everybody out there. Man, this is an amazing perspective. That's awesome. Okay, I'd like to have the Engstroms come up. The Engstroms work with a crew in Northwest Wisconsin here. And this is Tom and Tina, and then their oldest son, David, and then there's Joshua and Emily and Elena. And the AIM team, in conjunction with the guidance of our elders, it has been prayerfully supporting. And at the beginning of the new year, Calvary will be financially supporting the Engstrom's efforts at reaching the students in the area's institutions of higher learning. And Tom will give you a little.
So just real briefly, I guess. We obviously live here in Eau Claire. We know many of you, but we serve on a team in Eau Claire that reaches campuses in northwest Wisconsin. There's about 20-some college campuses, universities in all of northwest Wisconsin, with about 54,000 college students. And you think about that number, and you can imagine how many of them have never heard the gospel. And not only on those campuses are there 54,000 college students, but there are many faculty as well who desperately need to hear about Jesus. And so our desire, our team, we desire to just give each of those people an opportunity to hear what God has done for them and an opportunity to respond to Jesus. And so we're excited to do that. Currently, we have ministries on UW-Eau Claire, UW-Stout, and River Falls also, and then some smaller campuses. Well, CVTC here in Eau Claire, but then also some smaller, more distant campuses, two-year colleges in our area as well. And so we're excited to see how God will continue to move and to reach people with the gospel and to help build them up in their faith and to send them out to the world to really just to bring the gospel to the ends of the world. And you can imagine as students graduate just how they have the freedom and the ability to go places that most of us will never have the opportunity to go to. And so it's a real honor for us to be able to serve in that way.
All right. Thank you very, very much. The next, I would like to introduce the Gillies. Tim and Cheryl Gilley are missionaries to Wisconsin and to Minnesota. And they are with Awana. And beginning in the new year, Calvary will be financially supporting the efforts of Tim and Cheryl in this important work.
Thank you, Cecil. It is a pleasure to be here this morning. We are Tim and Cheryl Gilley. And thank you, church, for coming alongside of us and giving us the opportunity and the privilege and the means to serve about 2.5 million children under the age of 18 in the states of Minnesota and Wisconsin. And we have the privilege of helping churches reach that group of kids. And our goal, our mission is to come alongside of you and to provide training, provide leadership, encouragement, to come alongside of you and give you ideas, help you be most effective in reaching into the community right around this church so that kids can come here, they can be engaged with adults that love them, and those adults, you, can share the gospel with them. And that we're hoping and we're looking forward to that celebration in heaven when there are thousands of new faces in heaven because of the work you guys are doing. So thank you for joining us in that effort. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Two last things to share with you. Please consider daily supporting them in prayer and encouraging them in their efforts, both Engstrom's and the Gillies, to reach our community. And whenever and however you can support them and encourage them, please do so. All of our missionaries really need a word of encouragement. So if you can, in the back there's Christmas cards. Please take a moment to fill one out or to sign it. Just so that we can let them know that we really love and appreciate the work that they're doing. Okay? Thank you.
Joyful and triumphant. song lights up the stars. One breath, one breath that gives life. One sovereign power who speaks with thunder and fire. One Lord.
Other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And not only must be, but can be. There is no other hope. There is no other faith. There is no other joy. There is no other peace other than that which is found in Jesus, the one name, the one true God. And we adore you, and we give you praise today. Amen. You may be seated. As the kids are headed out to their teaching time of DiscoverLink, if you're ages 3 through pre-kindergarten, we have a special teaching time for them back there. Let me remind you of a couple of things that are coming up. Next Sunday morning, right here in this sanctuary, you will be transported to space. Not literally, but in your imaginations. It's our children's Christmas program next Sunday morning. And for the entire service, you will hear about the one true God who came to save us. So come, bring your friends, bring your family, bring the kids' grandparents and great-grandparents and all the aunts and uncles, and let's enjoy the celebration next Sunday of our children's Christmas program. Then on the 18th, we'll be regular service again with the second in our series of messages on the Word became flesh from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, that we'll get started with this morning in a moment. And then on December 24th, Saturday afternoon at 4:30, Christmas Eve, there will be a Christmas Eve service here at the church. It's going to be different than we've done in the past. We're not going to have a lot of talent show-type atmosphere. We're not going to have a lot of that kind of special music. It's going to be a time of true contemplation of the Word becoming flesh and dwelling among us. So come for Christmas Eve service at 4:30 on that Christmas Eve day. And then I know that this is a very strange request for all of you, but we would appreciate you spending Christmas Day, a portion of it, worshiping the Lord here at Calvary on Sunday morning, Christmas Day. Service time will be the same time as normal, 10:15. There will be a coffee fellowship at 9:45 for you to come. You have plenty of time to get up and open all your gifts at home and get dressed and still come to church for the real purpose, the real meaning of worshiping your Savior on Christmas Day. We will have a Christmas Day service here at Calvary on that Sunday. So that's kind of what's coming up for the holiday season. We would appreciate you participating where you can and enjoying time with family where you are able, because it's all about the celebration of Christ's love for us. So, why do we celebrate Christmas? Why do we? What is the big deal? This morning, during prayer time, that some of the men of the church gather at 8:15 with me every Sunday morning in my office to pray for me and for this message and for what God is going to do in our hearts today. And one of the men shared a story this morning that he had been in a store, and when he got up in the long line, when it was finally his turn, and the cashier was incredibly bubbly and cheerful. And he said, "Man, you're so busy." "Yeah, but it's Christmas." And he said, "So why do we celebrate, or why do we give gifts like this?" He first asked her, I guess I'm getting the story mixed up. He first asked her, he said, "You think most of these people are all buying Christmas gifts?" "Well, of course," she said. And he goes, "Well, why do you think we do that? Why do we do that?" And her response was, 'Tis the season. And he said, because there was still a long line and he didn't want to get into a big conversation, he said, I think it's because we celebrate the greatest gift that was ever given to us when God gave us Jesus. And she said, that'll be $22.50. And he said, well, he could have. He didn't say this, but it just came to me. He could have said, but what I just gave you is free. Why do we celebrate Christmas? Why? Of all the reasons that you could give and of all the things that would come off the top of your head, there's one thing that is super simple. It's a birthday party. It's a birthday party. And it doesn't matter what all of the negative critics of Christmas on the internet are that say, well, but yeah, it's not happening on the day that he was actually born, and it's actually a part of a pagan celebration, and it has lots of pagan. It's a birthday party. Celebrate the birthday of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Celebrate his birthday. Why should we celebrate his birthday? What makes him so special to require a worldwide celebration of his birth? That's what this series is about. The Word became flesh. There'll be four sermons in this series, and it will hopefully stimulate you to study even more. The first one today is going to be Christ's existence as God. What makes it so special to celebrate his birthday is that he is God. On the 18th, we're going to look at John 1, 4 through 9, and we're going to talk about Christ's enlightenment of man, his enlightening of man. He came as the light of the world. On New Year, on Christmas Eve, we're going to be looking at John 1, 14, Christ's entrance as God and man. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And then on Christmas morning, John 1, 14 and 18, Christ's expression of God to man. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the Father. The Word became flesh. Let's pray. Our Father, as we prepare to look at these three verses at the beginning of this passage of Scripture and share the fundamental principles of why we believe that Jesus is God in the flesh, may it be more than just a theology lesson. May it be something that stimulates us to consider the depth of our own belief and gives us truth to share with others who don't believe, so that the name of Jesus is exalted in all the earth. And I pray this in his name. Amen. Stand with me, please, as I read three verses from John 1, 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Thanks, you can sit down. Wow, that was short and sweet, simple, and profound. Profound. If you were to do a search on the internet, as I did this week, and type in the words Jesus, the deity of Jesus, or Jesus as God, you would come up with a whole bunch of wacky websites. You would come up with some good ones as well that delineate why Jesus is God and his deity. Three of those websites are listed on your information sheet for the sermon in the connector. If you have that little sermon note sheet and you flip it over to the back, you will notice up near the top there are three websites for you. I was going to create a QR code so that you could just scan them with your phone and get to them immediately, but then I knew that that's what you'd be doing during the sermon. Some of you are probably already typing those into your web browser on your phones or your iPads, but they're there for you because they give you a doctrinal basis that goes beyond what we're going to share with you today to prove that all those wacky sites that come from places like false religions that are surrounding us every day with their interpretation and rewriting of Scripture to where they have even rewritten the Scriptures so that it validates their point, so that in one of those denominations, one of those false religions, verse 1 of John 1:1 actually says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was a God," small g. So that they can prove their preferred theological position that Jesus is not one member of the Holy Trinity of God, the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, but that he is instead a created being by Jehovah God to serve as a God for us. And my guess is that in your life, at some point, you've had one of the representatives of those two false religions in our community knock on your door to try to tell you why they're right. They are not right, and they misinterpret Scripture. For the word here is very clear, and so let's break it down. The first three words of this passage are, "In the beginning." Well, the beginning of what? Well, that phrase is identical to the one used in the very first verse of the Bible, where in Genesis 1:1 we read, "In the beginning." In the beginning. In the beginning of what? In the beginning of all that we know to exist. For prior to anything existing that has any tangible relationship to the human race, prior to there being a single twinkle of a star in the sky, prior to there being a sun or a moon or planetary solar systems or a Milky Way galaxy or a universe at all, prior to there being a plant or any mineral or any form or substance to the earth, prior to anything, there was only God. For God exists outside of all context of time and space. He is in, to put it overly simplified, he's in another dimension. A dimension of which we have no knowledge or comprehension. In the beginning, when all things started, when God first uttered the very first words to say, "Let there be light," the light already existed. And God transformed nothing into something that was able to hold his essence. For God is light, and in him there is no darkness. And when he, on the first day of creation, said, "Let there be light," there was nothing other than his essence to provide the light. For there was no star, no sun, no moon, and yet there was light. Where did the light come from? God's first creative act was to transcend his dimension, to create a dimension in which humans would have time and space and that dimension was capable of carrying his essence, the essence of light, and his being shined in what he created. Prior to anything existing, God was. And because the Word was with him and was him, Christ eternally existed as well. Christ was in the beginning. He eternally existed when creation began. In the beginning was the Word. In other words, was. It was already there. It pre-existed the creation. And it was God. He, the Word, was God. Jesus said it this way in John chapter 8, verse 58. Before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. The great I am, in which God himself confessed in the Old Testament to Abraham, I am that I am. I am that I am. In other words, I have never been and I was. I have never been nor will I ever be and I am going to be. I am always I am. In other words, from eternity to eternity, which is an impossibility because there is no beginning of eternity and there is no end to eternity. It just is. And in the context of it being, then God is always exactly who he is. He never changes. And Jesus Christ has always been. In the beginning was Christ. He is eternal. And eternally equal with God the Father, and eternally equal with God the Holy Spirit in this amazing, indescribable configuration of the Holy Trinity of God, where the three in one are always equal and yet always distinct. Please don't ask me to explain it. Please understand that the Scripture says it is true. J. Gresham Machen, in his book, What is the Deity of Christ, writes this. Listen carefully. Follow along I'll make sure that we don't miss one point here especially. The Christian believes that there is a personal God, creator and ruler of the universe, a God who is infinite, eternal, and unchangeable. So when the Christian says that Jesus Christ is God, or when he says that he believes in the deity of Christ, he means that that same person who is known in history to us as Jesus of Nazareth, that same person existed before he became a man from all eternity as infinite, eternal, and unchangeable God, the second person of the Holy Trinity. And upon that truth, we stand and we do not negotiate. Jesus Christ is eternally God. And that's why we celebrate his birth as man, because it is God coming to us. Christ is identified here in this passage as the Word, as the Word. Capital W in all of your translations, and if it's not, get a new one. Seriously, if it's not capitalized W in your translation, please consider the validity and the source of your translation. Christ is identified as the Word. Let's talk about words for a minute. Words always begin as thoughts. Idealistically, you would always be wrong if you ever told someone, I didn't mean to say that. You understand that? Words always begin as thoughts. Thoughts only become words by a choice of the will. Therefore, you made a choice to say what you said. Now, you may have misspoken because your mind is old like mine, and sometimes it just comes out garbled. So you have to clarify. Let's be gracious to one another, shall we? Okay? But we also need to be considerate of our own ability to deceive ourselves into not admitting the flaws of our communication styles. Words always begin as thoughts. But let's talk about thoughts for a moment. Every one of you in this room knows what you think, but no one in this room knows how you think it. Okay, now, is it getting too philosophical for you? You know what you think. You just don't know how you thought it. No one here can explain how thoughts come to us. No one here can explain how thoughts are processed. No one can explain that. And yet we use those thoughts from which we have no concept of origin to express ourselves in communication. And that's why it's so inefficient. That's why communication is so inefficient. But listen, the Word knows both what God thinks and how God thinks. So Christ as the Word, the Greek word logos, Christ as logos equals the perfect communication of the divine to us, because he not only knows what God thinks, because he is God, he knows how God thinks, because he's eternal and knows everything. His omniscience, his ability to know everything. If God didn't know how he thought, then he can't be God, because he can't know everything. So God knows, even Jesus knows, even how God thinks, because he is God. Therefore, he can communicate to us the very heart and the mind of God. Jesus said it this way in John 14:9. He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. He is the perfect revealer of the heart and the mind of God. He communicates the divine to us perfectly. And because he communicated the mind and the heart of God to us perfectly, there is no other means by which we should be receiving any information about God. Jesus Christ is God's last word to mankind. He is the climax of divine revelation. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 says it this way. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. Now, if you were to look at that in the original Greek language, and I am no Greek expert, I trust the Greek experts that counsel me. In these last days, he has spoken to us. The perfect tense of that verb means it is once and for all, never to be needed again. Jesus Christ is the final word to mankind of God's redemptive purpose and who God is. False religions like to take this book and say, yeah, this is valid as far as it went. And then they add writings of their prophets to proclaim that there was more revelation about who God is and God's purpose for us than what Jesus Christ revealed himself. That is to deny this book as being the inspired word of God. If you believe that revelation can come to you from some other source than this book, that revelation of the very essence and nature and purpose of God can come to you from any source other than this book, then you have a false faith. And you must at that point believe that this book is not the inspired word of God, which it is. This is absolute truth. You need no other book to accent this, to discover and know God. And you certainly need no other book to enhance your understanding of God. And every other book written, no matter by who, and no matter how emotionally popular it could become, no other book can be rated as good unless it agrees in totality with the revelation of God through Jesus Christ. He is God's final word to us. Number four. The Word was with God and the Word was God. Christ is absolutely equal with God while also being distinct. I am not going to attempt to give you any kind of a practical illustration like water exists in three separate states. They've actually discovered just recently that water actually exists now in four different states, that there is a state immediately prior to either freezing or boiling or becoming steam that is a transitional state that they are identifying as a fourth state of H2O. I don't know if you read that recently in all of your physics publications that you get, like I don't. But I just happened to see it the other day when I was going through that they're identifying a fourth state of water. So you can't even use water as a very impractical illustration of the Trinity. And the reason that water doesn't serve as a practical illustration of the Trinity is that, yes, chemically in its nature, it's H2O, but it can't exist as steam and ice at the same time. And yet God does. God exists as Son, Father, and Holy Spirit all at the same time, never diminished by one of them having any purpose. They are all equal at all times and always equal to each other, and yet as one, they are totally God, and as three together, they are still totally God. By faith, we believe that through the power of the Holy Spirit in us to give us the faith to say yes and yes, amen and amen to that truth. But please don't ask for a practical illustration of it, because I can't give you one, and nobody else can either, because it is a concept that exists outside the confines of time and space of our created order. But how do we know that we are to know that from Scripture, that Christ is God? I'm going to look at two passages of Scripture. And then you have the websites there where you can do further study on your own. In Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 35, in one of the traditional Christmas passages, we read this. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at that saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." I want you to stop right there before I read the rest of it to another proof point. But you must read this in the understanding of how Mary would have understood it from her Jewish upbringing. In her Jewish upbringing, she would have been taught as a child throughout her first 15 or 16 years of life to whatever age she was at right now. She has been taught in the synagogues and by the teachers of the law that there was a Messiah coming promised in the Old Testament who would be the son and in the lineage of King David. And she's going, oh, I'm in the lineage of King David. And that this Messiah that would be born would be supernatural in his ability to rule the world for all time. Of his kingdom there will be no end. In other words, he will be an eternal being. And then the angel goes on. After Mary asks the question, and Mary said to the angel, how will this be since I am a virgin? How am I going to conceive a baby? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. Every human influence of sin will be removed from the conception process. There will be no male, human male DNA presented to her in the womb, so that the nature of sin cannot be passed on from Adam's seed to Mary's. Jesus would be born without a sin nature, not inherited from a human father. And the power of God would overshadow her womb so that none of the sin of her life would influence the conception or the growth of that baby, so that when born, Jesus Christ came forth as the Holy One of God. The virgin birth of Jesus is absolutely essential to a proper understanding of God's redemptive purpose, for there can be no Christ sacrifice for sin if the sacrifice for sin is deserving of the same punishment of sin, because he has sin. And Christ, the deity of God himself in human flesh, was born as God. Hebrews 1:1-3 says it this way, in verse 3 especially. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. And after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. He is the exact imprint of the nature of God. He is God himself. And the final point this morning is that by him and through him, all creation took place. All creation took place. Verse 3 of John 1 gives that clear definition. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Jesus Christ is the creative word. God created all things through Jesus Christ. This again is another place where those false religions of our community have changed the scripture to state that Jesus Christ was the first of God's creation and then given the authority to create everything else, because it's convenient for them not to believe that Jesus is God so that they can maintain their bondage over the people that they teach. Colossians 1:15-17 says this, he, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over. Our translations say of. Look at the Greek language. That means the firstborn over all creation, not the firstborn of creation. for by him all things were created. If Jesus had been created by God, then who created Jesus? Because he created all things. All things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authority, all things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Jesus is not a created being. Jesus is the incarnation of God himself into human flesh. Sounds to me like that's deserving of a birthday party. Sounds to me like it's time to celebrate. For he alone is God. He alone is worthy. Isaiah 7:14 prophesies of this event. When the prophet Isaiah says this, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. And behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." You know what the name Emmanuel means? God with us. God with us. In the beginning, Jesus existed eternally with God as the Word. The Word that spoke everything into existence. And that Word became a part of that existence so that he might meet its need. Listen to this.
The Christmas story. You know, the God born a man in a manger, all of that, escapes some moderns. Mostly, I think, because they seek complex answers to their questions, and this one is so utterly simple. For the cynics and the skeptics and the unconvinced, I submit a modern parable. The man I'm going to describe was not a Scrooge. He was a kind man, a decent, mostly good man, generous to his family, upright in his dealings with other men, but he just did not believe all of that incarnation stuff which the churches proclaim at Christmas time. It just did not make sense. And he was too honest to pretend otherwise. He could not swallow the Jesus story, the story about God coming to earth as a man. "I'm truly sorry to distress you," he told his wife, "but I'm not going with you to church this Christmas Eve." He said he'd feel like a hypocrite, that he would much rather stay home. But he said he would wait up for them. So he stayed, and they went to the midnight service. Shortly after the family drove away in the car, snow began to fall. He went to the window to watch the flurries getting heavier and heavier. Then he went back to the fireside chair, began to read his newspaper. But minutes later, he was startled by a thudding sound. And then another, and then another. At first he thought somebody must be throwing snowballs against his living room window. But when he went to the front door to investigate, he found a flock of birds huddled out there miserably in the snow. They had been caught in the storm, and in a desperate search for shelter, they had tried to fly through the large landscape window. Well, he couldn't let the poor creatures lie there and freeze. So he remembered the barn where his children stabled their pony. That would provide a warm shelter if he could just direct the birds to it. Quickly, he put on a coat and galoshes. He tramped through the deepening snow to the barn. He opened the doors wide and turned on a light. But the birds did not come in. He figured that food would entice them in. So he hurried back to the house, fetched some breadcrumbs, sprinkled the breadcrumbs in the snow, making a trail to the yellow-lighted, wide-open doorway of the stable. But to his dismay, the birds ignored the breadcrumbs and continued to flop around helplessly in the snow. He tried catching them. He tried shooing them into the barn by walking around them waving his arms. Instead, they scattered in every direction except into the warm, lighted barn. Well, then, of course, he realized that they were afraid of him. To them, he reasoned, "I'm a strange, terrifying creature. If only I could think of some way to let them know that they can trust me, that I'm not trying to hurt them, I'm trying to help them. But how?" Any move he made tended to frighten them, to confuse them. They just would not follow. They would not be led. They would not be shooed because they feared him. If only I could be a bird now and mingle with them and speak their language and tell them not to be afraid and show them the way to the safe, warm barn. But I would have to be one of them so that they could see and hear and understand. At that moment, the church bells began to ring. The sound reached his ears above the sounds of the wind, and he stood there listening to the bells, Adeste Fidelis. Listening to the bells pealing the glad tidings of Christmas. And he sank to his knees in the snow.
Father God, you came to meet our need. Emmanuel, God with us. Our need of sin that could not in any way be met of our own accord. And you came to provide for us the sacrifice necessary for the forgiveness of sin. And we celebrate that coming now in this communion service. Scott and elders, would you please come?
Good morning. I am Scott. I am in the process of becoming an elder here at Calvary. Actually, next month I'll be up here giving my testimony, so stay tuned for that. So what I want to do today as we take communion is, first of all, I want to look at Jesus' life a little bit. This time of the year we talk about him being born in a manger, which he was. Not the best situation, place to be born, but that's where he was born. He escaped death as a baby. When they were going to kill all the baby boys, he was put in a basket and sent down the stream. At a young age, he became a carpenter, probably a teenager. He probably built some amazing stuff with the tools that he had. And then at the age of 30, he went into ministry for a few years. And that's when his life took a slight turn. When he was mocked, called names, spit on, he had a crown of thorns driven into his head, he was beaten, nailed to the cross. And that's where he died. And why? Because Jesus knew that was our only way. That was our way of forgiveness of our sins. That was our only way to our Heavenly Father. It was through him. Our only way for eternal life was for him to suffer. to the point of him hanging there on that cross minutes before death. And he says, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The hands that tore the flesh off his back, he said, God, forgive them. That's powerful. He knew that's why he was sent. So I want us to reflect on our own lives. And if you know Jesus as your personal Savior here today, we invite you to join us. If you're a visitor here for the first time from a different church, as long as you know Jesus, we invite you to join us. But if you don't, we ask that you would not. If you ask why, during our time of prayer, I would ask you to come to one of these elders and ask them why. Maybe this is a question you've wondered for years. What is this? What does this mean? And I've taken communion before. Now he's telling me not to. We need to be right with God. So during this time, I would like you to feel free to come to the front and pray. Turn around in your chair and kneel and pray. Whatever the Holy Spirit leads you to do. We should never feel like we have to sit in our chair and just sit there and pray. We need to be free to move about. We don't have assigned seating here. So as you take time to reflect, whatever the Holy Spirit leads you to do, I would ask you to do that. So let's take this time for just a few moments, and I'll close in prayer at the end. Thank you for this time to reflect on what you've done for us, why you were sent, and to reflect on our own lives, to be right with you, to know that we're following the will of our Father. Thank you, Jesus. We just ask you to bless this moment in your name. Amen. I would ask the elders to come up. I will be handing out the gluten-free, so if you need that, please raise your hand and I will find you. Thank you. Jesus took this bread. After blessing it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Eat this. This is my body." And he took a cup. And when he said, "Give thanks," he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of all of you, for this is my blood, the covenant, which was poured out for many for their forgiveness of sins." Please pass your cups to the ends of the aisles and we'll pick them up for you also.
We adore thee.
keep us safe as we travel, and help us to shine your light to the world. In your wonderful name we pray, everyone says,
amen.
Amen. You're dismissed. Ooh.